Can I tell you my favorite scene in the film is the scene at the bar.
I knew it. I knew you were going to say that before you said it, man.
I was like, oh my God.
You're giving me goosebumps because it's a personal favorite of mine too.
Sean, I'm really excited about doing this and it's wonderful to meet you.
Nice to meet you. I'm happy to be here chatting with you.
I'm really excited because I saw your film last night and I have so much to ask you. And I was really excited that I was one of the first early people in India to see it. And like, it was a privilege. I absolutely loved The Adam Project. And I found myself like crying in the last scene of The Adam Project between the father and son. And that's what I took back with me, with the emotions. And I think that's the essence of spectacle movies. But also you walk out with an inherent emotion. Like my father meant the world to me. He's no more now. But like, I remember that everything I've ever watched in cinema that's moved me has always been father-son related. And at the core level, that's what The Adam Project is also about. It's about family. It's about the father and son. And I was absolutely swept by the emotional energy of the film.
Yeah, I mean, this is very gratifying. So thank you for kind of sharing that. It's very generous of you. That was the point. Someone asked me, well, what do you want your movies to make people feel? And my answer was, I want to make them feel. That is why I go to work. I don't make movies just to entertain myself or to convey ideas and concepts. I go to make a connection, and a connection that is inherently emotional. This is what gets me up in the morning. It's why I love filmmaking. I'm sure you agree. And I'm well aware that the cinema of India is unabashedly devoted to audience delight, audience joy, audience warmth. And those are the kinds of movies I love from any culture. And I feel like increasingly so many movies are either dark or somber or alienating, or they're pure spectacle, but not emotional. And I'd really love to believe that cinema can be both. And I wanted to make an emotional spectacle with The Adam Project. Ryan Reynolds and I met on Free Guy. And as soon as we met, we had this shared feeling that, oh wait, we're both at a stage of our careers and our lives where we want to actually tell stories that connect in a joyous manner and in a sunshine manner. Free Guy had that in its DNA. Obviously, Free Guy was much more of a comedy. Adam Project is more of an adventure drama. But the same goal, which is audience pleasure, audience delight, and look, it's a cynical world. It's a cynical world where I live. It's a cynical world where you live. But if we can tell stories that are like knives through that culture of cynicism and circumstances and a world that is so often, obviously, deeply disappointing. But if we can be like a knife that cuts through that with optimism, with emotionality, then I feel that this job has a purpose and an important purpose. And the more movies I've made, the more clear I am about that purpose.
You also brought together the most formidable cast. There's, of course, Ryan Reynolds and Jennifer Garner and Mark Ruffalo. And that's just fantastic. So many lead actors of prominence. It was an easy sell to all these actors to kind of come on board for this film.
It was an abnormally easy sell. You know, some of it is, thankfully, I think everyone kind of trusts that Ryan and I know how to do our jobs and we're going to make something good. But this idea, this movie's idea of what if you could go back and reconnect with your own history, with your mother, with your father, with yourself, and what new level of understanding and forgiveness and empathy would you gain if you could do that? That's a universal yearning. And every actor, Mark, Zoe Saldana, Jen Garner, everyone that I called had some very quick connection with that fundamental premise and how emotionally rich it is. So I'm thrilled with this cast. It was ambitious, the level of actors that we went after, but everyone said yes very quickly, and I feel very fortunate about that.
Can I tell you my favorite scene in the film is the scene at the bar?
I knew it. I knew you were going to say that before you said it, man.
Like, this is such a beautifully crafted scene as a director, but also so beautifully written and performed. And it was just like so simple in terms of its, in terms of your camera. It was like the camera was just like an insider. It was just like doing its job. Like there was no fuss, there was no treatment. It was just on close-ups and over the shoulder cutting. And it was just magical. Like, and I love the moment where she felt something and she went running onto the street and he wasn't there. But I felt like, what is the instruction you must have given Jennifer Garner to kind of get that expression? Because she was magical in that close-up.
Yeah, well, I have so many little answers to give you. First of all, I need to say, that was a very good scene. But then Ryan rewrote the scene himself. And
he
rewrote the scene himself as a love letter to his mother, who was the one constant in his childhood with a very unpredictable and imperfect father. It started with a Ryan Reynolds rewrite of the scene.
Right.
When we showed up, we started rehearsing, and you know, sometimes you're rehearsing a scene first thing in the morning,
right,
and you just feel like, oh, it's happening. It's happening. And you know, in those moments,
yeah,
for one thing, stop rehearsing. Stop
yeah.
rehearsing, start filming. And number two, get out of the way. Get out of the way. And so literally I was like, I'm going to say a bare minimum. I'm going to roll the cameras. I'm going to let the cameras move slowly in on each actor as the intimacy of the scene develops. I wanted to get visually more intimate with the actors. And I truly feel like that was a day where I didn't want the director's hand to be obvious. I wanted it to be trusting. And the only note I gave, we did a few takes of Jennifer Garner's close-up. They were all amazing. But she was so emotional. And I said, the only note I said, I was like, hold it back. Because what I found is when an actor is really crying a lot, it's beautiful, but it's not as poignant as someone who's trying not to cry.
Yeah.
And that was the one note I gave Jennifer.
That
and that's
beautiful.
What you see in the movie. You know what I love? And they would never say this about themselves, but I love that scene. It, particularly because Jennifer Garner and Ryan Reynolds have been very famous superstars for a long time.
Yeah. Yes.
And sometimes when someone is so famous for so long, you forget the actor because you are so conscious of the celebrity. And that was a day where I said to Jennifer and Ryan, today, you two are actors.
No, I mean, bona fide actors and bona fide talent. Emotions are universal. You know,
I agree.
We have so much, we see so much of spectacle and the VFX and scale, but eventually I cried in your film. And I think that was I had such a good cry, like in that scene, the last scene. I don't want to tell anyone about it because that was my second favorite moment of the film, is between Ryan Reynolds and Mark Ruffalo. And I was like, I just suddenly realized I had these tears just dropping from my face. And I had a good cry right after the film, because you end the film emotionally as well. It's just like you're just carrying that emotion right at the end. Is time travel a phenomena that has excited you, like way back from cinema goes, like Back to the Future itself? Or is it just a concept that's fascinated you?
Well, I mean, I have always found time travel a fascinating concept. I think that's fundamentally human, because it's the one constant of our existence as human beings that we are utterly powerless about.
Yes.
So I think it's inherently interesting, but I have never been a sci-fi wonk for purely genre purposes. I like genre that is emotional genre. Adam Project, I wanted to make a very emotional piece of science fiction. I wanted to make a sci-fi movie that does not look, feel, or sound or compute like sci-fi. I wanted to make a sci-fi premise as an adventure drama. And so all the choices I made with the wardrobe, with the camera, with the aesthetics, with the pacing, with the music, every decision was made with the priority of connecting in an emotional way, a humanist way, even though the genre is conceptual. That was the whole goal. And look, Adam Project is my 13th movie, which is kind of astounding to me. But you talk about front-footed, you know, early on, I remember when I made the Night at the Museum movies, and I was like, no, I want to be like a drama director. And I remember Chris Columbus, who was my producer on that, said to me, why are you running from the thing that is the most natural to you? You dismiss it because it comes easy to you, but it's not common. It's rare. And I remember that I was in my mid-30s at that point. And then several years later, Spielberg on Real Steel said to me, "You direct like you're sitting in the audience." And I always remembered those words, because since then, and that was now 10 years ago, I've thought, okay, you know what? This thing that comes naturally to me, emotional storytelling, yeah, I'm going to play off my front foot, and I'm not going to kind of apologize for it or try to put on different clothing because, oh, well, that's what the cool kids are doing. I can only tell my stories in the way that I want to tell them and the way I'd want to experience them as an audience member.
You also mentioned Spielberg, and I couldn't help but feel like, you know, there's always... No, I'm not saying it's an inspiration, but I could definitely think that you may have been a fan as a kid, you know, or maybe a little older than that, you know, because I know that I grew up on Spielberg myself and all his films. And I felt like he used to combine technology and emotion in the most beautiful manner, in a way that he made human dramas out
that's
of
well put. All his, you know. That's really, I'm going to be stealing that a lot. I'm just warning you, because I've got like 5 days of publicity now.
Yeah, of course. Sure,
and everyone's like, well, you know, there's a Spielbergian feeling to your work. Yeah. And yeah. I never really know what to say, but that's very interesting, because he's always using technology to create wonder.
Yes.
But it's always in the service of something human. And I think that you just articulated that in a very concise way. So thank you, because I will be stealing it.
That's fine. I'm giving you complete liberty to do so. There is a zone where I felt like this is like watching vintage Spielberg, but with today's technology and the same emotional impact. And that is something that I haven't seen any other filmmaker do in a really long time. I got it from the warmth of the house. I got it from the warmth of the characters. I got it in your costuming. I got it in the production design. I got it in everything.
Thank you. Because you mentioned wardrobe, for instance. One of the tiny things I'm so pleased with is I watched the movie too, and I'm like, those costumes could have been in the 70s. They could have been in the 90s. They could have been in 2021. And only when I was finished with the movie do I realize the extent to which I made every choice based on a certain timelessness, but also it is a kind of Amblin throwback Hollywood sensibility where it wants to be filled with spectacle. But like you, I watch so many VFX heavy spectacle movies that have cool visuals, but zero feeling. And I'm just not that interested in that.
I felt like your writing process must have been interesting, because you also simplified it to an extent that was
correct,
very easily accessible. And yet there was enough technology talked about that makes it sound clever as well. Was that a conscious endeavor?
Very. And it's a shared value of Ryan's and my together. We got scripts where it was really cool, but every time if Ryan and I ever said, wait, what does that mean? Wait, what's happening? You know what we did? We rewrote it and we changed it to words that we understood. And if we didn't understand, I would go to the writer and I'd go, tell me in dumb, basic words, what is happening? And the writer would tell me, and I'd say, okay, I'm going to use those words, because why do I want a movie to feel like homework? I want a movie to feel like a ride, not homework. And so it was a very conscious rewriting of the time travel rules to give enough information and complexity to make it interesting. But I never want an audience processing a movie up here when they should first and foremost be experiencing a movie here.
The kid, I mean, he's amazing. Like,
amazing.
He's really amazing. How was your experience working with him? Because I've worked with a lot of kids in my career. And it's
so have I. But I mean, I'm sure you know, if you've directed kids, I mean, look, the Cheaper by the Dozen, Night at the Museum, Real Steel, Stranger Things. I feel like you, between the two of us, we maybe have directed 400 children.
I have a child in every film of mine. And I mean, barring the one I'm making right now, everything else, I've directed many children. Yes, many.
So you know that, you know, you generally might get lucky and get certain moments on set, but you're doing a lot of work in editorial to craft a great performance. I'm not going to name any kids, but some of the kids in my movies who seem super talented, they're not. We just edited them really well. Walker Scobell in The Adam Project, Even live on set, no editing. He's just special. He just has an authenticity that is rare. He had never been in a TV show, a commercial, nothing. So I got him pure. I got just a pure, great kid who also was a crazy Deadpool fan. So I got this talented, authentic kid who also is a Ryan Reynolds expert before he ever met Ryan Reynolds. So you really believe that they're two versions of the same person because Walker knows how to channel Ryan's rhythms. Every actor needs to be directed in a different way. The way that I direct Zoe Saldana is very different than the way I direct Walker Scobell or Catherine Keener or Mark Ruffalo. Every person has a different language. And I find one of the great fascinations of this life and this job is, what is your language? Now I'm gonna find your language, because to do our job great, we need to access each person to bring out the best version of that person. This is my fuel. My actors are my inspiration, are my creative fuel. And so for Adam Project, where the content was so emotional, and so the process of making it was emotional, it's why it was one of my favorite movies to make and now to release. I said, when I watched the movie last time, I turned to Ryan and I said, this is my most me movie. This is the movie I've been meant to make.
I've seen a lot of your films and I can definitely say this one is really special. And it's it's going to move the world.
Again, I don't make movies for a niche. I make movies for the maximum audience possible. I make movies that want audience engagement. That is why I go to work every day. So Netflix has such a ubiquitous global scale of audience engagement that it makes it the perfect platform for a movie like this.
This is special in so many different ways because this film will be accessible to over 222 countries with millions, gazillion people watching your film all at the same time. Different cultures, different countries. That is just special.
Many people have started to watch the movie, people like yourself who were sent the movie early. And the reaction has been incredibly encouraging. But the best part is the people who have written Ryan or I these notes about how they watched it sitting on the couch with their son and how they'd never seen their son cry at a movie ever. And that this movie was a connective moment. Or they watched, someone wrote me yesterday that they came away from the movie and called their mom and realized that they treat their mom like crap too much of the time and don't voice the gratitude. So the fact that this movie is connecting to viewers in ways that are personal and are emotional and makes them consider their own life, their own connections and relationships in their family, that's a dream of an outcome. And it's very gratifying.
I think that you're going to spend an entire week and then many months post the release hearing a lot of great compliments and a lot of heartfelt stories about people's experiences while watching it, because it is an immensely connective experience. Watching The Adam Project.
Thank you.
Was an immensely immersive, it was a very connective and a very satisfying cinema experience more than anything else. And I wish you so much love and luck, because I know that everyone in India is going to absolutely love the film.
I can sincerely tell you, this was such a joyous chat. And again, when you watch me stealing your words in future interviews, remember I asked permission.
So congratulations, and I hope everyone loves your film the way I did. Thank you so much.
I really appreciate it. Nice chatting with you.
Thank you. It was great chatting with you, and see you soon.
Thanks.